Hello, welcome to Italics, the Italian American magazine. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. This episode of Italics is dedicated entirely to forms and acts of devotion, religious devotion, and one's personal devotion to family. First, we'll look at religious devotion. Through Graces Received, Painted and Metal Ex Voto from Italy, an exhibition currently on display at the Calandra Institute of the City University of New York. Graces Received, the catalog of the exhibit, has recently been published as a book on the subject. We'll talk with Dr. Leonard Primiano of Cabrini College, whose collection of ex votos and work on the subject constitute the foundation for the exhibition and catalog. Dr. Joseph Shora and Rosangela Briscesi of the Calandra Institute both collaborated with Dr. Primiano on the exhibit and catalog. Graces Received, Painted and Metal Ex Votos from Italy, is on exhibit at the Calandra Institute in Midtown Manhattan through May 25, 2012. Next on Italics, we'll talk with Chiara Montalto, a rising young playwright and actress. A Brooklyn love story, Emergency Use Candles, Miss Montalto's one-woman off-Broadway hit play, will open next fall in Los Angeles at Theater 68. Now let's go to the Calandra Institute to see Graces Received.
Around the tomb of St. Anthony in Padua stands an altar. Around that altar, people have left pictures of their parts. St. Anthony healed my arm, and here is a silver arm. Hammered silver arms hang at all angles, thousands of them. The Cloister Museum has hundreds of feet, eyeballs, knees. Sant'Antonio di Padova, finder of lost things, also heals the sick. Padova is the seat of an ancient school of medicine. Many paintings record accidents miraculously survived. Ex voto, because of a vow. Each piece records a vow. In gratitude for healing my heart, I send this picture. Some paintings are of children restored to happiness. There is a plaster cast of two hands. People send their wedding rings. Nothing is too small for St. Anthony. He will help you find your glasses, if that's what you need. Many of the paintings have St. Anthony in them. Others seem to be looking at him, as if he were standing inside you. Thank you for healing me, they say. Thank you for finding my glasses.
I want to say always from the beginning that I am not in agony when I speak. People are not used to necessarily encountering someone like me who's had major throat surgery. It was 5 years ago. As you can see, I'm still very much alive and very much functioning. Unfortunately, religious studies has only recently become interested in material things and what they call material religion. Ex voto is a Latin word. In Christianity, and certainly most specifically in Roman Catholicism, that there would be individuals who would pray to the Virgin Mary, to saints, to God, to Jesus, and would make a vow for a healing, for something that they wanted to receive, and that they wanted to give a gift back to show that that vow had been fulfilled. And they did that through objects, and they did that through paintings, which a series of folk artists in their local community would make for them. So I want to begin, well, that tradition was in Europe and Italy, and in the United States, the form of that tradition is best known through the Mexican example of it. Now, this is Our Lady of Solitude. This is a nicely underpriced Mexican ex voto santo for the home. And found this one, which I think is of a very unusual subject, the three kings in the Mexican tradition, but it's beautifully colorful, and again, these are most often have been painted on tin or some cheap metal that is available, and we could pass that around. Again, I've had that framed. Now, obviously, I wanted to show you these North American examples because those are the ex-votos that you would most commonly find in North America and that you would most commonly be able to actually purchase and have in your home if you wanted one. You could find them in folk art dealers from coast to coast, and it's even possible to find them on eBay. But I would warn you, of course, to watch exactly whether it's an authentic object on eBay or not. The Italian, or even the French, or German, or Swiss ex-voto is something else altogether. A very difficult object to find in America. Ex-voto are not only paintings, but they also take the form of limbs or body parts that have been cured. And so you could have a sterling silver art, or a sterling silver leg, or arm, or eyes, or breasts, or kidneys. And I've seen these as well in shops, as I said, in Europe, in Germany, etc. Now, believe it or not, about 5 years ago, I noticed that on the American market, there began to appear some of these objects. Gradually, I was able to acquire these objects. And so, believe it or not, everything you see in the gallery later, I have acquired within the last 5 years. So in this one, we have a man who's been trampled by the horse of a cart, and Virgin Mary has assisted in some way. Maybe the horse missed him, he wasn't heavily damaged or whatever, saying that the priest who is blessing the sick person, right, that is San Camillo, and I just don't see that in the iconography at all. It doesn't look like that at all. It looks more like an ex-voto to a regional Virgin Mary. And I think the beautiful artfulness of that flowering sort of frame is really fantastic. And these are essentially miracle stories about these supernatural events which have been visualized by these painters. All I can say is, ouch. So this gentleman has gotten wedged somehow between this machinery, and this gentleman is either successfully trying to turn it off or get him away from it or whatever. But it is, I think, really fantastic, and he even has blood coming out of the man in the back, trying to make it as graphic as possible. It's really really unusual and beautiful, and it's 1881 ex-voto.
What's the price range for these
Oh, everybody always
paintings.
Asks me that. The response is as low as you can get.
Well, I mean, the ones that you have.
It depends. Believe it or not, I bought some of those paintings for as low as $250.
Thank you.
And so but they could be as high as $1,000, $2,000, $3,000.
When the wished for thing comes about, the sickness cured, then what form is the vow? Do people vow money or acts of devotion? What do they do in return that they are commemorating in the painting?
Right. Well, the act, don't forget, it starts with a prayer. And so it's the sense that, you know, the individual is making the vow that they will have a public exclamation of the healing if the healing happens, or if the blessing comes. The first ex-voto that I ever knew in America was Danny Thomas's Hospital for Children in Memphis, Tennessee. Because if you remember the comedian Danny Thomas, that hospital is the fulfillment of a vow that he made as when he was starting out as an actor. He would build this cancer hospital in fulfillment of the fact that his career would flourish. And that is why there's this massive hospital in Memphis today.
Leonard reminds me about the diversity of ex-voters. We're looking at very artistic ex-voters, but they can take many, many, many forms. People who have been to shrines can see the crutches that people lay at the shrines. They bring there after being healed. It could be the dress of a child, the baptismal dress of a child who has been healed. In one case in Italy, a packet of cigarettes were left as a votive offering. So they could be the most humblest object, or as well as also behaviors. Walking barefoot to the sanctuary is a votive act. Question was asked, did immigrants bring this tradition to the United States? And they did to some degree. But in my field work, I did come across Natale Rotondi, who died just a couple of years ago, and he made this one votive painting, which he signed in the back and labeled Voto. And I prayed, and I said, if I get out of this woods, I've got to create a Voto. And so when I got better, then I began to paint this, which depicts a dying man. Let's just say he's just about to die. And the cross appears in the sky. The cross represents all the things that we have to endure on earth. And then the dove of peace, which if I was to die, there would be peace. But that was the only example that I found of a painted Italian-American ex voto, until I came across a really important book called Miracles on the Border by Jorge Durante and Douglas Macy, who documented Mexican ex votos that depicted scenes of immigration across the border. This was a really important book because it made me think a little bit about where these paintings may be. And the more I looked around in the United States, the less I found, and I began to realize that the Italian-American ex voto was not here in the United States, but in fact, in Italy. So here you see an example from 1892, and of Anna Grosso, who, as it says in the painting itself, is living in America, and she evokes the Madonna of the Flowers. It was interesting to try to track all the iconography, the various aspects of the Virgin Mary. This is probably the oldest example from the mid-1900s, and according to the caption, it's from this one book on Italian, images of Italian immigration to the United States. This is of a family who came from this one region in the region of Piemonte, and who eventually settled in New York City and created a toy factory. So there's a number of scenes, as in the as Leonard was sort of was referring to before, the more industrial era, more and more scenes of the actual immigration experience concerning Italian immigrants to the United States. As I said, many of these images are publications, not only on Italian immigration, but Italian publications, Italian immigration, but Italian publications themselves. And here, this is a the graces received from St. Bernard to Luigi Caranata, and it says actually in the painting, grace received in America from 1892. It's not clear where exactly, whether it's sort of the coal mines of Pennsylvania or West Virginia. These plaques of various forms are found in Italy, and this is a roadside shrine in the Edicola Sacre, seen here in Rome. Here in the United States, of wax ex votos. And here's one such vendor. The important thing about the ex voto is that they're not private exchanges. While they are between a single individual and the Virgin Mary and one of the saints, they are almost always, in Italy and in the United States, in one form or the other, public events. They are a public expression of devotion and belief in the efficacy of the supernatural. And here again, you see St. Rocco from Roosevelt Street from 1937. That same feast continues today. It's been revived to a large degree because of the importance that these religious objects continue to have in a post-Vatican II era for American Catholics. The other way that votive candles were not simply a candle that you can hold in one hand. They could be 6 feet tall. You can see on the right are the women carrying, or sort of standing with candles that are as tall as them. A number of them are walking barefoot, or at least this woman is walking barefoot. And here you can see a number of cinti being carried and publicly brought to the Church of Our Lady of Mount Carmel. In New York City, in particular in Brooklyn, yard shrines are particularly prevalent images. And they can be done for purely devotional reasons, but they are most often done for votive reasons. A miracle has happened, and the vow that's made is to create this public statement of the miracle itself. Just a few examples that I've collected over the years. In 1944, the Chinachi family of Gravesend commissioned a neighboring mason to build a fieldstone shrine to the Virgin in thanks for the safe return of sons serving in the military during World War II. In 1980, Rose Scaracella asked her husband to build a grotto in front of their Bensonhurst home after she prayed to the Blessed Mother on behalf of her son John, who overcame a seven-year battle with Hodgkin's disease. Vito Lopiccolo of Bensonhurst asked Paisano Giovanni Gaioletto to build a shrine of brick, marble, and wrought iron to St. Joseph, who was successfully petitioned to relieve a paralysis of the leg. He wrote at the bottom of the shrine, "A promise fulfilled," Vito Lopiccolo. There are many forms of a votive act. It doesn't necessarily need to be an object, and sort of making a pilgrimage is a votive act, and that is clearly part of an Irish Catholic tradition as well.
Our second look at devotion involves one's dedication to family. Next on Italics, we'll talk with Chiara Montalto, a rising young playwright and actress. A Brooklyn love story, Emergency Use Candles, is based on Miss Montalto's relationship with her grandfather while living with and caring for him after her grandmother's passing. Miss Montalto's one-woman off-Broadway hit play will open next fall in Los Angeles at Theater 68. Italics correspondent Lucia Grillo spoke recently with Miss Montalto.
Sweetheart, can you play me my phone messages?
Beep. Hello, Andrew. This is Raffaella, the usherette from St. Mary's.
Whack job!
I would really appreciate it if you could give me a call back at 1-718-428-1376. I know you know my number. 1-718-428-1376. I am in dire need of your assistance.
What a pain in the ass. I am not interested in her. There was only one love in my life, and that was your grandmother.
Hello, Andrew. This is Raffaella again. I'm leaving you another message. I need your help. Please call me 1-718-428-1376. Andrew, this is Raffaella. What the hell? Did you go to Florida or Italy or something? Can you call me back? I need your help. Thank you. Andrew, I've left you several messages. I'm starting to get worried. Andrew, this is Raffaella. I need financial assistance.
Aha! I knew it.
I have no money to go to the doctor. I have no money, no family, no children. Please call me. I hope you didn't die. 1-718-428-1376.
What we just saw was a clip from the acclaimed one-woman show, Emergency Used Candles, A Brooklyn Love Story. And we're here with a writer and actress, Chiara Montalto, who created and performs the piece.
Hi.
So tell us about Andrew and Raffaella.
Well, Andrew was, in fact, my grandfather, and with whom I lived for 10 years in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn. And I wrote a play about that experience. And Raffaella was an old lady in the neighborhood who was somewhat obsessed with him and would constantly create drama in her life to try and get his attention.
So how did this all come about, that from the idea for the story through the development process?
Well, I found myself at 20 years old, living with my grandfather. My grandmother had died very suddenly. I was in college at the time, and I was looking for a place anyway, and he was just there, and we were always very, very close, and my grandfather was a very special person, and I just couldn't have him being alone, and I couldn't leave him, you know? Like, I got to know him. I had the incredible opportunity to know my grandfather, not only as my grandfather, but to be his friend, and I wound up with him for almost 10 years. Until he passed.
I love the juxtaposition of you, like a modern New York woman, with this 85-year-old man, your grandfather, and this relationship.
We used to say we were like an odd couple, you know. Like, so, I mean, it was just what defined us. You know, we were so. I was at college. I went to the new school. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I couldn't have gone to a more progressive, like, university. There I was. It was very traditional. But, you know, I should also say that my grandfather was a very atypical man. Mm-hmm. He was always so open. You know, he was never someone who viewed anybody by their race or their age or he didn't judge people. He was just always very open and very accepting. Like, I would have these, like, parties. He would go upstairs, he'd put on his suit and tie, and he would come down, and he would literally, like, be hanging out with me and my college friends all night long. So I was like, this is pretty funny. You know, like, I knew that it was fodder for great humor there. Not that I felt he or I were particularly interesting, but I knew the situation would lend itself to comedy. Mm-hmm. And so I first started writing in this very institution at the Calandra Institute. I was a part of a writing workshop here many, yeah. many years ago. And it was the first time I really started to just be writing about this on a regular basis. I would leave him with a legal pad and a pencil. And whatever crazy thing we had just been discussing, I would ask him just to write down his notes. And, like, he literally wrote an essay on life and death that winds up in a tray of lasagna. And so I had this, you know, collection of his writings. And he passed, and it took a couple of years, but with a mutual friend of ours, Teresa Gamba Corta, who is the one who first said to me, like, you know, why don't you consider writing this as a one-woman show? And we sat and we went through everything that I had and rendered the first texts of what became my play.
And the title, I mean, the Brooklyn love story part I think we get, but with emergency used candles, where did that come from?
I'm taking a guy home to Pop's house, Jesus Christ. I just might go to hell for this. I brilliantly have the driver drop us on the corner just in case Pop is up and sees or hears anything from out his bedroom window. You're gonna go in through the basement door. Wait for me in my room. I'm gonna go in through the upstairs door just so everything is all right for my Pop. Sweetheart, is that you? Yes. Pop? Isn't it late for a work night? Yeah, I know I work late. A big deadline at work. I'm going to bed. I love you. I'll see you in the morning. And mwah! I make my way downstairs.
Kiara tiptoes to the basement.
Oh my God. I just realized I'm so embarrassed because I bet Pop didn't put away all the candles in the candle tomb. That's what I call the basement, the candle tomb. Pop keeps this old shoebox clearly marked emergency used candles. It's full, catacomb of candles. There are old corn on the cob candles from 1967 and Christmas candles from every year since, half burned, red, green, silver with ribbons and bows. I always make fun of him. I always tell him, you must have survived the Great Depression and the Dark Ages.
You'll see, sweetheart, you kids think you know everything. It's good to have a box of emergency used candles just in case. Pop
Stop, get out of my head. I'm trying to get laid over here.
So I would get crazy because I'd be like, what, just throw them away. What do we need 3,500, you know, half-burned candles for? Like, what is this about? And he's, see. And I'm sure, as you remember, we had a blackout. Mm-hmm. And when we had that blackout, I came home to find him sitting in the living room with every single one of those candles lit. And I, all he said was, I told you so. So it's my little metaphor for how he prepared me for life.
With the performances of this play, you've set some records.
Well, it's certainly been, I've been so fortunate and so blessed, and I've had such a good run in New York. I was a part of Emerging Artists Theater. They have a wonderful festival that they put together. I did sell out Emerging Artists, and I was produced at the Cherry Lane. I've been fortunate.
What's next for this play and for you?
The play is now directed by Ronnie Marmo of General Hospital, another mutual friend of ours who also happens to be the artistic director of the 68 Cent Crew Theater Company, which we are both part of. Okay. And I'm going to be doing a run at 68 in LA. And then we're both involved in 68 New York, which I worked with Ronnie to open this past August and mm-hmm. September, and now we're gearing up to our first production, which you are directing and I am acting in.
The one act go up.
It's in March 29th to April 27th at the Drum Bookshop.
On 40th Street,
yeah.
Where can people go to find out more?
Well, I have a website, chiaramontalto.com, and 68 is theater68.com.
Thanks so much for coming here and spending this time with us.
Before closing, there are a few upcoming events I'd like to mention. Amerigo's America, 1512 to 2012, an exhibition on the life and influence of Florentine explorer Amerigo Vespucci, after whom America is named, is on display at the Manhattan campus of St. John's University from February 28th through March 2nd. This will be the only stop of this exhibition in America during its world tour, marking Vespucci's death 500 years ago. On March 25th and March 26th, Italics presents on CUNY TV our coverage of last year's official 100th commemoration of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire, a 90-minute special. On May 17, the AP exam in Italian will be administered for the first time since its suspension 2 years ago. You can access all necessary information on how to enroll by visiting the website usspeaksitalian.org. Well, that's it for this episode. Again, thanks for watching. I'm Anthony Tamburri. See you next time. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.